Okay, so I believe we can start now. So my name is Michele Paolino. I'm active and talking about software-defined vehicle in AGL since 2016. And yes, you recall, right? Dan and Walt. So actually, now is the right time to, more and more is the right time to talk about these topics. Today, I'm going to show you what we have done today, what we have done this year in the context of the VIRT.io loopback activity of the SDV expert group. So, VIRT.io loopback is a technology that we designed and implemented last year in the context of SDV expert group. I will start reminding you more or less what it is and why we have done it in that way. After, I'm going through a short description of the updates done in this year. I have also a small demo related to Yoast User Sound that I'm going to show you, and then, of course, what's next and what are the proposed features for 2024, or in any case, for the future. So let's start from what VIRT.io loopback is. I believe Jerry Sun was very clear yesterday when he said we wanted to build an application, we want to run it anywhere, meaning cloud, real hardware, or virtualized systems. So this is actually the real objective of this technology that is called VIRT.io loopback. What we have done is to build a bridge between the driver you see there in kernel space, in the pinkish side of the square. So a bridge between the driver, the VIRT.io driver. You can imagine a VIRT.io driver like, I don't know, VIRT.io Sound, VIRT.io Video, VIRT.io Net, all the VIRT.io drivers that you might be using today. We build a bridge between this driver and an application in user space. To do this, of course, we implement some mechanisms that are in the middle based on shared memory. And what it is important to say is that the application that is now in user space is able to implement all the machinery needed to respond to the driver requests. Usually, the very common case is that this user space application is what they call Yoast user devices. So devices built for being run in user space. This is very common in, again, in NFV. So in the network field, this is very common with Yoast user net. So the network drivers usually today are run in user space, at least in NFV. The reason why they do this is mainly performance. They are able to pin a core, for instance, to these drivers in user space. But of course, there are also other reasons that are led to the fact that user space is easier to maintain, to develop than kernel space in general. More details, about the benefits of this technology. Well, number one, you can already reuse existing driver. So we don't want to touch VIRT.io Sound, VIRT.io Net, VIRT.io CAN, and all the other implementations that are already there. This means that for you, as an application developer, using this technology is transparent. So you don't need to know what it is inside. Second benefit, is that the fact that using VIRT.io, we are hypervisor agnostic. So we don't really focus given hypervisor. This is a technology that runs mostly on the host side, okay? Because actually when you are using an hypervisor, you are already in a virtualized system. You will use loopback when you want to use a VM built for a virtual machine inside your host, okay? Second benefit is about shared memory. So we designed everything in a way that performance should be impacted as less as possible. Of course, we are adding some intermediate steps, so we expect some performance drop. This is something that we measured last year. It was not really, it was something negligible. It was around 5-6%. So higher shared memory, better performance. Then the third part is the fact that being connected with Virtio, Virtio now is a community that is getting bigger and bigger. It started being something only data center related, but now finally everybody is using it. For this reason, using Virtio means using something that will be open also in future and stable for a long time. So. The two pictures here below shows applications that run both in a native side and in a VM. These now let's talk about a bit of the design. So how the solution works. There are mainly two new components being added. What you see in yellow already exists. So is already your application with some kind of libraries that maybe is put in the middle. Your Virtio driver is already there. And many VHOST user devices on the right are already available. As I said, we build a bridge. So the components that we added are the ones you can see there. One in user space, the second in kernel space. Let's go a bit better into the details of each one of two, of the two. Kernel space has been enriched with a new transport. So every Virtio driver then uses a transport to really connect to the real hardware. The transport can be MMIO, PCI Express, anything that is, let's say, a bit more real than the Virtio interface. In this case, we build a new transport, it is called loopback, which simply doesn't forward the calls directly to the hardware, for instance, in memory, like MMIO does, but actually forwards everything in user space, okay? In user space, we have a new component that we call adapter. The adapter is actually a component that set up the communication between the device on the right and the driver on the left. So the adapter is the guy who says, here are your V-rings. This is a notification of a control message that you should consider and things like that. If you see the picture, you will see that there are system calls, usually IOCTLs, sockets used by the user space applications. The Virtio loopback adapter has a lot in common with Chemio, in the sense that today, if you have any experience with VHOST user devices, you already used Chemio plus KVM, typically. Chemio implements, well, maybe it's better to say the opposite, the adapter implements part of the Chemio code, which is actually all the library needed to discuss with the VHOST user devices. Because today, VHOST user devices expect to talk with Chemio. So we have simply, we are, let's say, emulating Chemio, giving, respecting exactly the same APIs, and provided exactly the same response to the drivers, to the device. So the device is interacting with our adapter in the same way as the device is interacting with Chemio. For this reason, it's also important to say that this is another component that you don't need to modify, okay? So today, what we do is simply we take existing devices and we make them work in this architecture. More details about, maybe I already anticipated some of them. So in kernel space, we have a char device and the transport. The char device is the one that exposes the IOCTL. You can see how then there is an mmap syscall from the user space device that enables actually shared memory between the driver and the application itself. While on the adapter side, this is actually a C application, uses EventFD and Unix sockets to talk with the user space devices. And here we have IOCTLs together with EventFD. So these are the components that are in place in this architecture. I went through a kind of, let's say, a wrap-up of what it is. Now I'm, let's say, able to talk about what's next. Well, what was the activity, not what's next. What was the activity of 2023? So we started the year having a few devices available in this architecture. Bulk, RNG, and Input were the devices that we presented last year in Yokohama. These were both Rust in the RNG case and Input and C-based in the case of Bulk and Input. This means that we were able to use in with the architecture that I showed you, VHost user BLK, VHost user RNG, and VHost user Input. Now, this year, things went a bit farther. We added new devices. GPIO, I2C, and CAN, and Sound are already functional-wise complete. We are working now to integrate them in AGL in a way that you can build your image with everything you need directly from Yocto. We have some activity ongoing, being console and the GPU, okay? These are things that are ongoing and that are today under development and that we will be presenting probably next time. Together with adding new devices, we also worked at the infrastructure level, meaning we improved the code of the architecture as it was before. In the version of last year, we were needing some changes at the devices at the device level. As I said, now this is not anymore the case. You can use directly things that are commonly available and, of course, supported. A few more details about two special devices that we encountered this year. There is no upstream version available of VHost device CAN and the VHost device console. So we had to build the devices first and then all the rest. The devices are now almost ready, let's say in cleaning version, at least for CAN. Console, as I said, is under development, but this is something we'll finish very, very soon. And we target to share this code with VHost device, which is actually the common Rust crate for this type of things. So all the VHost devices that are written in Rust are available in this crate. And the plan in the next weeks, it is actually something that is very imminent, will be to make sure that CAN and console that we implemented ourselves will be then integrated there. The ongoing work is related to GPU and sound. So for what concerns the GPU, the implementation that we are targeting is the C1, so what you actually find available in Chemio. There are other possibilities, but for instance, there are solutions that are based on Rust. However, they are not so stable. For this reason, we went for the C implementation. I will come back to you probably in the next months with this, because today this is still under development. For what concerns sound, we were working on a very recent implementation done in the crate that I mentioned before by Red Hat and Linaro. So they are really implementing the device in these days. As a matter of fact, the device is under the staging folder of the crate, meaning it's something that is not yet very, very stable. And this is what we are using in the demo that I'm going to show you. Sorry, guys. Laptop is dead. Jerry, do you have a power adapter, USB-C? Because maybe it's this one that is failing. No? Yeah. So if there is any question in the meantime, I can take them. LibreOffice always want to recover something from the previous. So objectives of the demonstrations. Sorry for the interruption. So we are actually having, well, the demonstration is about the Yoast device sound. So the a very recent implementation from Linaro and Red Hat. This is a Rust crate. So what we want to actually show you is, number one, we are showing the latest version of the loopback infrastructure. So if you are using any of these components, please be aware that the kernel driver was updated. Then we are actually running a special scenario I will tell you more later. So we are demonstrating the feasibility of handling complex scenarios. Then the objective is also to identify bottlenecks and additional requirements for the next developments. And actually what we want to do is also to highlight the benefit of dealing with this type of devices in user space, okay? The hardware that we are using is an AGL reference hardware platform, and of course the OS is AGL Pike. When in one of the latest AGL calls, we were asked by the IC work group, so the instrument cluster work group, if it was possible to use VHOST user sound and to connect it to multiple containers. Okay, what they want to do really is to have two containers with two devices, different devices, with a different level of priority. Because actually what they have is an instrument cluster container and something that is QM. So the solution that we were agreeing during the discussion, during our expert group discussions, was, okay, today we didn't think about it because we didn't design at the beginning, at least up to now, we didn't think about such a scenario. So we duplicated all the components in a way that there is complete separation between the VHOST user sound infrastructure of one application with the VHOST user sound infrastructure of the second application. Like it would be if you have a container which is an instrument cluster and something else that might be more IVI-ish, let's say. What it is good in this thing, in this actually new architecture, is that at the end of the day, you could use user space applications to prioritize between the two. In the sense that it is pipewire at this point that is able to say one container has the priority, the other one doesn't, okay? So let's go to see the video that I prepared. Let me move it on the other screen. Going to stop in a second. So we have several windows actually here because you have seen there are several components. On this side, we are going to insert two VRTIO sound modules, one for one application, the other for the other application. This window is showing the current devices, audio devices. You will see that at a certain point, a new VHOST sound device will appear, two of them, actually. Then we have here general D-messages, so actually general logs related to the communication between the applications and the kernel space. And on this side, we have sound device, adapter, and adapter. So sound device and adapter for the first application, sound device and adapter for the second application. So first VHOST sound module was inserted. You see that the message is saying something there. Now we are going to enter the second one. Well, actually, VHOST loopback module. This brings the registration of the new device. Now, when we start the first of the two VHOST user devices, and then the adapter, you can see that something changed at the VHOST sound level.
So before we were not having this Mirta Yohan card that now was added when the device, the OS sound device connected with the one of the two adapters. Now, same story for the second adapter. And the second VHOST user sound device. This will bring another VIRTIO card there. So at this point, we have two cards registered in the kernel. So the kernel knows that there are additional sound cards. We have the devices there on top that are actually emulating, reproducing the device. In this case, the device is actually simply writing, asking a pipe wire to play something, okay? Because actually this is let's say, host-based execution. And now we are ready to play something. Hold a second. This was the first sound. Then we go with the second one, and then the first takes over. Okay? So actually, the very last point, which is important, maybe should be described again. What we have done is we reproduce the first beep, beep, beep. Then we ask the second device to reproduce beep. And then actually when the second device beep is over, we go back to the very first one. So there is a priority with the second application in respect with the first one, okay? This is something that we had for free, in the sense that this is something that Pipewire gives us, okay? And this is one of the reasons why the instrument cluster EG group is interested in this technology. So they wanted to have an easy way to handle this type of priorities, and they don't want to mess up with the kernel, because actually, when you mess up with the kernel, of course, it is doable. However, it tends to be slightly more complicated and less portable. So let's go back to the final part of the presentation after the demo. So this is what you have seen, the two devices that were actually playing, the first and then the second, that then at a certain point were conflicting with Pipewire giving priority to one of them. Now, this is about the sound device, the sound support. For what concerns the rest, in general, development status is that we added new devices. Two of them were built from scratch, CAN and console. The other devices, CAN, GPIO, and console, are completed. Console is in finalization phase. This week, we can, at the end of this week, probably is ready to be shared. GPU is ongoing. We are working together with Jan Simon to integrate everything in AGL. We created the new repositories for the driver and the adapter. These repositories are available under the AGL Garrett system. So if you want to have the latest version or to see what is in the latest version, you can reach out there. Additionally, we added a new feature. Well, we changed the behavior of AGL AGVirt feature. So today, when you build an AGL image and you add the AGL EGVirt feature, you are automatically including VIRTIO loopback. So this is a way for ease testing from your side. We are testing it on mainly reference hardware, meaning ARCA H3.
However, we know it works also on a virtualized system. So if you try to build exactly the same thing during, well, say it in another way, during the development, we use with virtual machines. So we know it works with VMs. And then we port everything on the H3. Okay, so meaning that if you want to test, you can use a VM, or alternatively, you could go for the real hardware, meaning an H3. Okay. Next steps. So we have additional work to do. Of course, finalizing what still needs to be done on GPU and console side. Then there is a new task to open, which is the AWS one. So the idea is to enable also Amazon images with virtual loop back inside. This is a way for us, for instance, to emulate devices for CI usage, for instance, and also a way to enable seamless portability of an application inside AWS or inside your PC or inside your embedded devices. We also, as I mentioned, are going to go upstream with the crates with the Rust VMM crate for CAN and console. So this is something else that we are going to do. Benchmarks are not yet available in the sense that we are working on the feature and integration. Benchmark will be available very likely. This is something that we will be available in the next event next year, very, very early next year. Last point on my side, what can be done next? Well, the activity is now steadily ongoing. We could add new devices. This is a possibility. But there is also a lot of work that could be done on AWS side, meaning actually the fact that we are now breaking the barrier between the embedded and the cloud brings us in a good position to start doing things also with AWS directly. For what concerns new features, one possibility could be to go deeper into the multi-device support, meaning support the same architecture that I have demonstrated before, but with a kind of more native support in a way that the adapter is aware of multiple streams coming and could also do the arbiter job that Pipewire is doing, because we are, let's say, in the sound case, we have Pipewire, but in case of CAN or any other device, we might not have such abstraction that helps things. So this add multi-device support goes in this direction. The second part was something we discussed already. We have already a spec for this, is about the cross ECU, meaning that today we have this bridge between driver and an application running on the same CPU, one in kernel space, the other one in user space. This cross ECU wants to go farther, meaning the driver is on one CPU, or vice versa. The application is in another processor. This means that we can spawn, let's say, the component of the architecture between, for instance, an R core and an A core, Cortex A and Cortex R, in a way that, for instance, also Cortex R could access part of the Cortex A features. So that's all on my side. Conclusions. Work ongoing, something else still to do about AWS, console, and GPU. Integration is something that is happening really these days, so if you might encounter some troubles if you try to do these things tomorrow, but in a few weeks from now, this should be fixed, okay? Project finalization is expected end of 2023. So everything that I mentioned, at least internally, the results of everything I mentioned, at least internally in the expert group, will be shared as early as possible, very likely by the end of the year. Okay. So, questions?
Do you plan to upstream Vata loop back to the upstream Linux kernel, not the automotive kernel?
Well, this is something that can be, it's actually simply a transport driver. So it is a driver, doesn't need to be, it's not part of the kernel core. It's something you can plug and unplug. So we are actually putting the driver is already in this, the where I have the sources. So you see Virtio loopback driver is where you can find the sources. For now, we did not share it yet with the kernel on the kernel side. This is something as soon as the maturity is a bit stronger, we will do. We are in contact with part of the Virtio community for this. So people know that we are working on this. Last year, we had occasion to discuss also with the videos guys, the videos team, who is doing something similar, but for the data center case. So yeah, this is more or less all. So not yet. However, it will be done as soon as there is more testing.
So you will keep maintaining these drivers out of source, out of tree. Kind of.
Here, yes.
Yes, thank you. And you mentioned the videos. So how are you interacting with VDPA or videos people?
Yes, we do. We do. And we had already discussions. Last year in the ALS 2022, we have also benchmarked videos against this solution. So there are slides available. So if you want, you can have a look. In brief, the comparison is not that easy because actually the only devices that we have in common is bulk, BLK, so storage. So we did it, and actually there were similar performance between the two.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other question? Well, if not, in any case, you can just ask these days if you find me or join the SDV call biweekly. So feel free to ask anytime. That's thank you then.